Recorded Books presents a Griot audio production, The Morning After, by Kendra Norman-Bellamy and Hank Stewart. This unabridged recording is narrated by Kevin R. Free. This book is copyrighted 2010 by Kendra Norman-Bellamy and Hank Stewart. This recording is copyrighted 2010 by Recorded Books, producer and publisher of Griot Audio, celebrating the best in contemporary African-American fiction and nonfiction. And now, The Morning After.
Prologue. Ms. Essie was dead, but life still had to go on. How to make that happen, no one was exactly sure. Somehow, the people she left behind had to find a way to pick up the pieces and move forward. In the short time that her neighbors had come to know her on a personal level, Essie Mae Richardson had become the glue that held them together. Now that she was gone, so was their adhesiveness. Slowly but surely, they were falling apart. She had lived a long, full life, but for those who had only recently gotten to know her, Ms. Essie had been taken away from them way too soon. The morning after she slipped away peacefully in her sleep, all of the newly established friends of the 77-year-old woman tried to muzzle their emotions in order to honor their promises to her. Just a day before Essie went to join her beloved husband Ben in heaven, several of the residents of the Braxton Park subdivision agreed to put all of their plans on hold and go to Sunday morning worship with her. They'd had no idea that Essie wouldn't be there with them, but a promise was a promise. It seemed like the entire city was mourning the death of the community's pillar, or maybe that's just the way it felt to the people who loved her the most. The funeral home where her body was still being prepared for burial had hung a beautiful black satin wreath on her door, and dozens of the people who lived in neighboring houses had placed roses, cards, and stuffed animals on her porch. It was clear that Essie was adored, loved, perhaps, even more deeply than she'd known. Whether they had a personal connection with her or just remembered her as the wise old woman who sat on her front porch, waving at nearby neighborhood children, knitting a new blanket, or swaying in her rocking chair as she sang songs or read her Bible, everyone who had been touched by Essie's life had also been affected by her death. At times, a sense of hopelessness seemed to encircle her former neighborhood. Her vacant porch, the car that no longer left the driveway on Sunday mornings, and the absence of the tantalizing aromas that used to seep from her kitchen all the way out into her front yard. All of them were signs that Essie no longer lived at 216 Braxton Way. The morning after her death, the forecast didn't warn of rainfall. But right when that Sunday morning service was just getting into full swing, water fell from the sky and delivered a wave of flash floods to the whole of Georgia's capital.
"Listen at that," Reverend Owen said, gazing at the ceiling of the church as he took the podium and opened his Bible in preparation to deliver the sermon of the day. "Jesus and the angels done shouted so hard in celebration of Sister Essie's homecoming, till heaven done sprung a leak."
Those simple words immediately lightened the dismal mood that had encompassed the sanctuary from the moment the announcement was made that the church's oldest member had passed away. As soon as Reverend Owens had finished his declaration, the bow-tie-wearing organist rolled his fingers across the keys of the 10-year-old Hammond 926 classic organ, and the music that burst forth seemed to light a fire under the behinds of more than half the worshipers. From the pulpit to the back door, men and women, old and young alike, began dancing to the music and the beat of the drums. All of a sudden, the gathering that had started out as a dignified service to honor Essie's memory turned into a shout-a-thon worthy of a video clip on YouTube. Men sprinted around the building like they'd suddenly become Carl Lewis. Women danced out of their hats, wigs, and even a few half-slips. Most of the choir vacated the choir stand and congregated on the roomier pulpit so that they could get their praise on, too.
That's right! That's right!
Reverend Owens urged into the microphone as he skipped his short, rotund frame across the pulpit in jubilance.
That's what Sister Essie would have wanted! Praise him, everybody! Another one of God's children done made it in! Praise him!
That took the service to a whole new level. The few ushers who hadn't gotten caught up in the spirit themselves raced to keep the runners from colliding into one another and the dancers from becoming an entangled pile of flesh. Even the children took advantage of the opportunity to scream and jump around energetically without being reprimanded or made to take a seat. The fact that Essie's death was no reason to mourn or weep had all at once become clear to almost everyone in the 50-year-old edifice. Almost everyone. In all of their spiritual rejoicing, the pastor and members of the Temple of God's Word didn't detect the still heartbroken first-time visitors who sat together on the padded pew in the rear of the church. With just over 200 members, the five guests, four of which hadn't been on the inside of a church in years, went unnoticed. Neither the pastor nor the members saw Elaine's tears or Mason's confusion. They didn't realize Jennifer's despair or TK's anguish at seeing the suffering of his friends. And not one of the dancing worshippers noticed the 14-year-old boy who was so angry at their joy that he couldn't stand to spend one more moment inside the walls of the church where Essie used to spend her Sunday mornings. Before his mother could stop him, Jerrod dashed for the exit doors, removed his new dress shoes, and ran barefooted, more than 5 miles toward home. Chapter 1. 1 year later. Jerrod's story.
Ma, I'm going next door to help Ms. Angel, okay?
He called from the front door of the home that he shared with his mother. Jerrod turned around when he heard Jennifer step from the kitchen. She used a dish towel to dry her hands and said,
I thought you were going to watch Austin while I got dinner ready. He don't need me to watch him no more.
Jerrod pointed to Angel's sleeping one-year-old toddler while he spoke.
Miss Angel's over there by herself, and I know she needs some help. I'm done with my homework, so I can go help her pack up some of Miss Essie's things. I don't know, Jerrod.
A look of apprehension settled in on Jennifer's face.
I think it's real nice that you want to help, but packing up Miss Essie's things could turn out to be a lot harder than you might think. Do you really believe you can handle being in her house again after all this time and seeing all her stuff get packed away?
Jerrod tightened his jaws and swallowed. He hadn't been inside Essie's house since the wee hours of that morning when they found her there, barely alive. Moments later, she was pronounced dead. That was a year ago. Ever since then, Jerrod had trouble just passing the vacant property where Essie used to live. Going inside hadn't even been a consideration until now. This morning, Jerrod was determined to do it. He'd given himself the pep talk last night, telling himself that it was time to man up and stop being a coward. Just the thought of placing all of Essie's belongings in boxes and putting them away somewhere, never to see them again, was tugging heavily at his heart. But he couldn't let his mother see the strain. Jerrod's claim that his plan was to help Angel was only partially true. In reality, he needed to do it for himself. He hoped that somehow, by helping to pack away the things that belonged to the woman that he'd come to love dearly, it would in some way help him bring closure to the pain of the loss of her and bring an end to a year of restless sleep. If Angel, a woman who was closer to Essie than anyone else, could gather the courage to go inside Essie's house and dismantle her things, Jerrod reasoned that he could too. Essie would want him to be strong and do what he needed to do. And for Jerrod, it was important that Essie be proud.
"You ain't got to worry about me, Ma,"
he answered, trying to shrug his shoulders in as carefree a manner as he could muster.
"It's cool. I got this."
Jennifer smiled, embracing her son, who over the past year had grown to a height that exceeded hers by 2 inches.
"All right, then. When you get over there, let Angel know that her baby is in good hands and tell her that she and Colin can eat dinner with us if they want to. It's already late, and I know she won't feel like cooking. My food won't be as good as Miss Essie's, but it'll serve the same purpose."
"Okay." Jerrod had barely gotten the one-word reply out of his mouth before the front door of his house closed behind him. He'd had to rush out as soon as he could to keep his building emotions hidden from his mother. Hearing Jennifer mention their former neighbor's cooking seemed to smother Jerrod. He needed to breathe. After inhaling deeply for the third time and releasing the breath into the comfortably warm spring air, Jerrod wiped a threatening tear from the corner of his left eye and walked down the steps of the front porch. His mother's home was only a few feet away from Essie's. As he climbed up the steps that would lead him to his former neighbor's front door, Jerrod stopped to mentally prepare himself to walk inside. He had gone through a myriad of emotions in the year since he watched the mortuary staff lower Essie's stunning white marble casket into the ground. It had been a beautiful funeral, despite the sad occasion. Essie didn't have any living family members, but no one would guess that from the crowd. Never before had Jerrod seen so many people try to fit in one church. Temple of God's Word was clearly too small to accommodate the demand, but Angel felt that it was the place of worship where Essie would want her service to be held. There were as many people standing on the outside as were sitting on the inside. Old, young, and middle-aged people. Black, white, and Asian people. Family, friends, and just plain nosy people. A few tears were shed, but most were too busy praising to weep. Even from the inside of the edifice, Jerrod could hear a frequent "Hallelujah!" and an occasional "Praise our show enough God!" from those who could only listen to what was taking place on the inside. In the early days following her demise, all Jerrod felt was overwhelming sadness. He refused to cry at the funeral, and he dared not fall apart at school. But at home, it was a different story. Many nights, Jennifer sat up with him, and sometimes she cried with him, too. Those nights when it was too much for his mom to handle, she called for the assistance of T.K. Donaldson, Jared's track coach, who also happened to be his mother's steady boyfriend. T.K. had been a big source of support and strength. He had become Jared's hero of sorts. But as much as Jerrod admired and respected the man that he simply referred to as Coach D, he tried not to get too close. Over the years, he'd seen his mother's boyfriends come and go, and the last thing he needed was to become too attached to TK, and then have his heart broken, yet again, by a man whose relationship with Jennifer didn't work out. After the devastating sadness eased, Jerrod found himself angry. Not at anyone in particular, just angry with the world. It didn't seem fair that Essie would be taken away from him at such a crucial time in his life. He needed her, and without her strong hand to set him straight when he found himself making the wrong choices, Jerrod feared that he'd slowly drift back into the old ways that he'd just broken away from shortly before she died.
"The best thing you could ever do to honor Ms. Essie's memory is to keep your determination to stay out of trouble and keep your grades up. If you do that, you can always feel a sense of satisfaction because you will know that even from heaven, she's proudly smiling down on you."
That was what TK told him back then, and that was what Jerrod had been focused on doing. It was important to him to have Essie's approval, even from the grave. Jerrod had promised her that he would continue to respect his mother and do well in school, and somehow, no matter what, he had to keep his word. This school year, his grades were better than they'd ever been. For the first time in his life, he had made honor roll in the first semester. And this term, he'd not once been sent to the office for misbehavior. That was a milestone that even the principal had commended.
Hey, Jerrod, are you coming over to help out?
Angel's voice broke into his thoughts, and only then did Jerrod notice that he'd just been standing on Essie's porch, staring at nothing in particular.
Yeah, I mean, yes, ma'am.
As far as Jerrod was concerned, Angel, who was still in her 20s, wasn't old enough to be categorized as a ma'am. But Essie had taught him that it was just proper to show respect when talking to adults.
Ma said I could come over and see if you needed any help.
I sure do.
Angel smiled at him, but the whites of her eyes carried a hint of pink. Jerrod wondered if she'd been crying. If so, sadness wasn't detected in her voice as she added,
I never knew that Ms. Essie had so much stuff until I started trying to get it packed. I hate that Colin couldn't be off to help me, but you'll do just fine. Come on in.
He was a bit fearful at first, but as Jerrod stepped through the open door, he immediately felt at home, just like he did when Essie was there. As he continued to follow Angel, Jerrod couldn't help but take note of her flattering figure as she strolled ahead of him. When he was first introduced to her, Angel's belly was swollen with Austin growing on the inside of her. And for a few months following the delivery, she wore oversized clothing to hide her still bloated stomach and expanded hips. Now she had lost all of the post-pregnancy weight, and in Jared's eyes, Angel was as fine as any of the girls at his school who had never even had babies. A stifled grin made the corners of Jared's lips quiver.
No wonder Mr. Colin is always so happy.
I've been working on Miss Essie's bedroom, getting some of the clothes and other personal belongings packed, Angel announced, snapping Jerrod from his mannish deliberations. There are two boxes in that corner over there. You can start taking the things from the shelves here in the living room and pack them away. The photos can go in one box and all the other decorative items in the other. If you don't mind a little extra work, I need you to use pages from this newspaper to wrap each of the pictures before putting them in the box. I don't want to break any of the frames.
Aight, Jerrod said, his eyes scanning the shelves that lined the living room walls.
You think you can handle that? I didn't give you too much, did I?
Jerrod accepted the old Sunday edition of the Atlanta Journal-Constitution from Angel and almost laughed at the unnecessary concern in her eyes.
No, ma'am. It's all good.
Great.
She released a heavy sigh before heading back toward the bedroom.
Call me if you need help or if you have questions about anything.
The task of packing away all of Essie's whatnots and pictures took more effort and was more time-consuming than Jerrod first thought it would be. Sometimes it was his own curiosity that slowed his progress. He had seen many of the pictures on the shelves in the times that he had visited Essie's home, but there were several that he'd never noticed before, and he took the time to admire each one before putting them away. Each framed image seemed to tell its own story of a particular time in the elderly woman's life. The photo of a youthful Benjamin and Essie Richardson had always been the centerpiece of the middle shelf. Though time had faded the photo a bit, it was still easy to see that Essie's soft, beautiful features and his strong, handsome ones made them an attractive couple. The wood-framed picture was larger than all of the others, and that alone made it the automatic focal point. Jerrod began carefully wrapping it in sheets of newspaper, and he couldn't help but smile as he thought of how happy Essie must have been to be back in the arms of the man who had died so many years before her. The next photograph that caught Jared's attention was one of Essie sitting in her rocking chair on the porch. His heartbeats quickened as he reached for the picture, and held it in his hand. This was the way he would always remember her. With the possible exception of the kitchen, the porch seemed to be Essie's favorite place to be. That was where she was the first time Jerrod had seen her. It apparently brought her great joy to sit and watch the happenings in her community. Jerrod sighed. He'd give almost anything to see Essie Mae Richardson again. Just to hear her voice, giving him a word of advice, would be a welcome sound. She often visited him in his dreams, but to come into contact with the strong presence of her while he was awake would be a wonderful experience. Bong! The sudden sound of the grandfather clock in the corner stunned Jerrod as it resonated through the house. The teenager's hands trembled, and the photo that he had been holding slipped from his grasp and fell to the floor. Had it not been for the plush area rug beneath his feet, the protective glass would have shattered. Jerrod, are you okay? Spinning around, Jerrod looked at Angel, who stood beside the living room sofa, looking at him with concerned eyes. He felt warm moisture on the sides of his face and realized that tears had begun streaming from his eyes. Using his bare arms, he wiped them away and then kneeled on the floor to pick up the photo and to hide his embarrassment.
Jerrod?
Yes, ma'am, I'm fine, he said, without looking up. Jerrod hoped that Angel would just go back into the bedroom and continue with whatever it was that she was doing in there, but he heard her footsteps nearing him, and from the corner of his eye, he saw her sit on the Lazy Boy where Essie often sat and watched The Price is Right, the only show that she looked at on a daily basis.
Jerrod.
It took all of the boy's strength to steady his trembling lips. Jerrod wasn't intending to be rude by ignoring Angel's call, but he knew that if he opened his mouth, he'd lose the battle that he fought to hold back a rush of tears. Slipping from the chair, Angel sat on the floor next to him. Jared's vision was so blurred by the rising flood that he couldn't see clearly. But he felt Angel's hands cover his while he continued to hold securely to Essie's photograph. Complete silence dominated the room for a moment, and Jerrod wrestled not to even blink, knowing that doing so would be all the push that his awaiting tears needed.
It's okay to cry, Jerrod, Angel whispered. I do it all the time. I know how hard it is. Why do you think I waited a whole year to pack her things away? It took me that long to be able to come in here and do it, that's why. Miss Essie wasn't a blood relative of mine, but I'd known her all of my life, and she had always been like a grandmother to me. It's painful for me to come to grips with the fact that she never got to hold Austin, and he will never get the chance to personally know the woman who was more influential in my life than even my own mother.
Despite his valiant efforts, silent tears slipped from each of Jared's eyes and ran down his cheeks. They met at his chin and then dropped to the floor.
None of us were ready for her to die, Jerrod, Angel continued. And although every single time I cry, I feel like Miss Essie is scolding me and telling me not to be sad because she's in a much better place, I still cry.
Why didn't she tell us she was going to die? Jerrod blurted the words, and his voice trembled as he choked back the onset of heavier tears. Angel squeezed his hand.
She didn't know she was going to die, Jerrod.
Yes, she did. His reply was accusing. Miss Essie knew everything. She knew when people were coming by to visit. She knew when something was on your mind. She knew when it was going to rain. She knew everything, Miss Angel. She had to know she was going to die. Why she didn't tell us? After a brief, thoughtful silence, Angel wiped a tear from her own eye and then replied,
Let's just say she did know, Jerrod. Had she told us, would it have made a difference? Would you be any less hurt than you are now? Would you have been any more ready for her to die than you were then? I know I wouldn't have. And not only that, but if Miss Essie had told me she was going to die, I would have been so sad that I probably couldn't have enjoyed Austin's birth. You probably would have been so sad that you wouldn't have been able to eat or sleep. Think about it, Jerrod. If what you say is true, and she really did know that God would come and take her early that Saturday morning, maybe she didn't tell us because she wanted us to be happy. Maybe Ms. Essie knew that the only way she could die happy was if we were all living happy. It made perfect sense, but it didn't soothe his wounded heart. Jerrod decided that he'd have to deal with the embarrassment of Angel seeing him sob some other time. Conceding to the fact that he was neither man enough nor strong enough to keep his emotions in check any longer, Jerrod brought his hands to his face and wept harder than he had in months. He felt Angel's arms embrace him and pull him closer to her. He didn't see her tears, but he knew she was crying too. Some days, Jerrod could go a full 24 hours without being overcome with sadness at the thought that Essie Mae Richardson would never again be a part of his life. Today wasn't one of those days. Chapter 2. Elaine's Story. 411 days. Or was it 412? She had lost track of the precise number, but whatever the length of time, it had been far longer than she'd expected. When Elaine had the brief illicit affair that almost ended her then 7-year-old marriage, she knew that regaining Mason's trust would be an uphill battle. And she recalled very well the day that she told him that she was willing to wait as long as he needed. But Elaine had no idea of the punishment she had signed up for. She was afraid to check, but somehow she had the feeling that she qualified for inclusion in the Guinness Book of World Records for being the woman to go without intimacy for the longest period of time within her marriage. It wasn't a feat for which she'd want to take credit. As she sat at her computer in her home office, typing the final lines to the health and fitness article that would appear in an upcoming issue of Ladies' Home Journal, Elaine struggled to keep her focus. She loved her husband, and she felt deserving of being punished. But she didn't know how much more she could handle.
"At least we're still together," she mumbled, trying to focus on the positive.
Zoning in on the good in every situation and minimizing the bad was something she'd learned from Essie. But sometimes Elaine wondered if remaining in such a strained relationship was a positive thing after all. It was beginning to take its toll. Knowing that the bulk of the recent stress that their marriage had endured had been caused by her own infidelity, Elaine tried to remain patient while her husband dealt with everything at his own pace. Coming to grips that she had cheated on him had been very difficult for Mason, and Elaine had to admit that in spite of everything, he'd come a long way from where he was at the start of the mayhem. For weeks following the reveal of her adultery, he would barely talk to her. And when he did begin opening the lines of communication, he struggled to look at her when he talked. Now, conversation was no longer an issue. They spoke with ease, even sharing laughs on occasion. But that was about all they shared. Elaine never dreamed that a year would pass with Mason still sleeping on the sofa. She was beginning to feel as though she had a housemate, not a husband. In the early days of the sleeping arrangements that Mason had implemented, adding a mile to her morning runs seemed to relieve some of the frustration of not being able to spend any intimate time with the man she loved. But as those days turned into weeks, and the weeks expanded into months, no amount of exercise was satisfying her physical and emotional needs.
"Elaine, you here?"
Mason's voice, calling from somewhere in the living room, took her by surprise. Elaine had been so absorbed in her own thoughts that she hadn't even heard him come in the front door. She looked at the clock in the lower right-hand corner of her computer. He was right on time.
"Yes, I'm here."
As she responded, she slid her rolling desk chair away from the computer and started down the hall to meet him. It was nearing 7 o'clock. Her work had kept her so involved that she'd failed to finish preparing dinner. It would only take 10 minutes to cook the boil-and-bag rice that she would serve as a side dish to the peppered steak and gravy she'd cooked earlier. Elaine came to a stop at the mouth of the hallway and watched Mason struggle to pull his shirt over his head. He always came home from hauling loads, smelling like a mixture of gasoline and sweat. Emerging love handles were evidence of the lack of exercise that his truck driving job allowed. But none of that doused Elaine's yearning to touch and be touched by him. Their marriage had seen some good days in years past. No one in her entire life, including the chiseled-framed Bermudian that she'd allowed herself to be swept away by, had ever loved her on the same level as Mason. It had been a long time since she'd been with him, but Elaine hadn't forgotten what it was like.
Hey.
Mason's single-word greeting shook Elaine from her mindless gaze.
Hey,
she replied, embarrassed that he had caught her longing stare. Her face felt flushed.
How was work?
Okay. What about you? You done with the story you were talking about last night?
Elaine walked past him as she responded.
Almost, but not quite. I had to set it aside to meet a deadline on an article I was assigned. I'll be finished with both before the end of the evening, though. Are you about ready to eat? It'll be a few minutes.
No problem, I got a shower first anyway.
Everything will be ready by then.
Mason went into the bedroom and eased the door shut. The rule was unwritten and unspoken, but Elaine knew that any time he closed the bedroom door behind him, she wasn't allowed inside. Most evenings when he returned home from his local halls, he showered in the guest bathroom down the hall near Elaine's office, but today he wanted to use his own. The master bath stall was more spacious, and unlike in the guest bath, this one's showerhead had massage settings. Why should he have to be the one to get second best? After all, it was Elaine who had messed up everything by inviting another man to enter territory where he had no business.
Okay, dude, cut it out.
Mason whispered harshly as he rubbed his eyes to try to wipe away the visual that often found its way into his mind. Every time he thought he was over it, mental snapshots resurfaced of Elaine and Dante pawing passionately at one another. For Mason, the thought of it served as a relentless form of torture.
Listen, man. I know you don't want to hear this, but maybe it's time for you to seek psychological help along with spiritual counsel.
TK had told him just last Saturday as Mason shared lunch with him and their mutual friend, Colin Stevens. Ever since the morning after Essie's death, the three men had bonded. For Mason, the friendship had taken some getting used to, but it was one that he knew he needed. All of his life, he was accustomed to having friends who wasted away every non-working hour of the day, driving fast cars or sitting around playing poker, eating barbecue, and drinking beer. And breaking away from the bad company hadn't been easy. Over the last year, Collins and TK's more productive lifestyles had been good examples for Mason. The banker and high school coach, respectively, had shown him that having fun didn't require him to spend large amounts of money that his blue-collar job couldn't afford. And it certainly didn't call for him to spend hours away from home, leaving his wife to wonder about his whereabouts. But in all of their influence, Colin and TK hadn't convinced him to seek help for his inability to resume a normal marriage. Mason was already shaking his head before TK could finish the sentence.
Man, I told you before. That ain't for me. I ain't going to no quack. You can forget that, bruh. It just ain't gonna happen.
If you stop seeing them as quacks, then you won't see it as a bad thing, TK insisted. There's nothing wrong with seeing a professional. And if you can find one who is also a minister of God, why wouldn't you?
Forget it, coach,
Mason said, pausing to take a long sip from his glass of water.
I'm a man, and I'm not about to spill my guts to no stranger. I can handle my own problems.
Oh, really? Colin eyed Mason like he was daring him to lie for a second time. TK tried again. Going to a professional doesn't compromise your manhood, Mason. Plenty of real men see psychologists. It's been over a year, Colin added. Do you know how long a year is? That's 365 days, man. And for you, you have to add another month or so to that. Man, it's been over 400 days for you and Elaine. That's crazy. Colin slapped himself on the forehead for theatrical effect. Actually, that's insane. I mean, I couldn't imagine going nearly that long without making love to my wife. Not by choice, anyway.
Yeah, well, I bet you can't imagine your wife sexing up with some other dude by choice, either.
Shh. Keep your voice down, TK warned, taking a quick look around the room. You don't want to tell your private business to one psychiatric specialist, but you don't mind telling it to a room full of spectators. Before Mason could reply, Colin spoke again. Look, Mason, you're right. I can't imagine Angel stepping out on me like that. And I'm not trying to downplay what Elaine did. She was wrong, man, and nobody's denying that. Even she knows that she was wrong. But how long are you going to keep kicking her in the butt for her misbehavior? How long do you plan to make her suffer? Mason shrugged as he took another bite of his meal.
Man, Elaine ain't suffering. She's doing just fine. I need just a little while longer, that's all. She's waited this long with no problem, and she'll be all right till I can work through this.
Colin and TK's demeanors clearly indicated that they didn't agree, but neither pressed the issue any further, and Mason had been thankful for that. But now, as he recalled the expression on his wife's face as she watched him remove his shirt, he wondered if they were right. Was Elaine suffering? Behind that strong exterior, was she yearning for him? The questions in Mason's mind were temporarily rinsed away under the pressure of the pulsating water spewing from the showerhead, pouring over his tired body. 10 minutes later, when he finally emerged from the relaxing hot shower and stepped into the coolness of his bedroom, his thoughts returned. Mason sat on the edge of the mattress and continued to use the towel to absorb the moisture from his skin. The strong smell of the smothered steak dinner that awaited him edged its way under the crack of his bedroom door and massaged his nostrils. Elaine had been trying very hard to please him since their reconciliation began all those months ago. She had been keeping a cleaner house, cooking on an almost daily basis, and giving him all the space he needed. Not once had she pressured him for intimacy. She'd kept her end of the bargain.
Man, what's wrong with you?
Mason whispered to himself as he slipped on a fresh shirt and then stepped into a pair of blue jeans that were fitting snugger than usual around his expanding waist. He'd picked up 15 pounds since Essie's death, a stark contrast from Elaine, who seemed to be shedding weight every week. Mason's eyes fell to the ice blue nightgown that lay draped across the bed. It must have been new because he'd never seen his wife wear it. He imagined that the satin fabric would fall beautifully over her new, slimmer curves. Many nights, as Elaine walked around the house in her sleepwear, Mason would steal glances and long to reach out to her. His friends didn't understand the depth of his plight. They didn't know the half of it. It wasn't that he wouldn't make love to his wife. He couldn't make love to her. As badly as Mason desired to be with Elaine, the haunting thoughts of her with another man had all but paralyzed him from the waist down. And it was frightening.
Maybe it's time you seek psychological help along with spiritual counsel.
TK's words ricocheted in Mason's head, begging him to comply, but he couldn't get himself to do it. The whole situation was just too embarrassing. What was he going to tell the quack? Was he actually supposed to admit to only being half a man? He wouldn't tell that to his own biological brothers, let alone a medical professional or a clergyman. Some things were just better kept unsaid, and this was one of them. Mason suddenly shuddered as though a draft of cold air had burst through his closed bedroom windows. All his brothers were fathers, whether they were husbands or not. Having babies was a big deal in his family. and of his mother's children, Mason was the only one who hadn't added any branches to the family tree. Until now, he'd escaped ridicule because of Elaine's multiple miscarriages. But if news of his new plight leaked out, Mason would become the shame of his mother and the laughingstock of his siblings. Even as he sat on the edge of his bed, Mason could almost hear the jokes of not being able to make his soldier salute or his flag fly at full mast. His brothers loved him as much as they knew how to, growing up in a family as detached as theirs. But they could be ruthless. There was just no way he would admit to anyone that he couldn't get his body to respond to his desires. He'd just have to wait it out.
"I ain't the first man that's been cheated on, and I won't be the last," Mason said, keeping his voice level low so that Elaine wouldn't hear him. "I'm gonna get through this. I just need a little more time, that's all. I'm a man," he added,
trying to keep himself convinced as he gently ran his index finger down the soft material of the gown that still lay on top of the bed comforter.
"I'm a man, and I'll get through this. I have to find a way to get through this."
Chapter 3. Colin's Story. He held the phone to his ear and channeled all of his energies into remaining professional.
"Yes, ma'am. I understand. And I apologize on behalf of..." "Right. Right. I have everything I need in order to take care of it." "You have been given every reason to be upset, Mrs.—"
"Yes, ma'am."
"Absolutely. I will give you a follow-up call next week."
"Yes, ma'am. Wednesday at the latest."
"Yes. Yes. All right. Yes, I understand that, and we'll be in touch."
"Yes, ma'am. You have my word."
"Thank you, Mrs. Chambers. Have a good day."
"No, ma'am. I'm not trying to be facetious.
"Yes, ma'am. I'm sorry that your day has already been doomed due to our incompetence."
"Yes, ma'am.
The level of our stupidity staggers me as well. I fully understand your disdain, and I will take care of it personally."
"Yes, ma'am.
You have my direct number if you need anything further."
"Sure thing.
Bye."
Swear words that hadn't been a part of his vocabulary in years seemed to dangle on the end of Colin's tongue. Not the everyday made-for-cable TV words, but the really offensive kind. If he could just whisper them in the wind, he knew it would somehow relieve the insurmountable frustration he felt inside. Colin figured that if no one heard him, all would be well, no harm done. But someone would hear him, and offending him would be far worse than ruffling the feathers of any of his co-workers or the bank's clients. Even with the knowledge of it all, the temptation was still there. Colin had been saved for a long time, but submitting to God's will wasn't always easy, especially when everything around him seemed to be unraveling at the seams. Colin closed his eyes and prayed in silence. These days, he found himself doing a lot of that. When he was done, the desire to spit profanity had diminished, but the aggravation remained.
"That was 30 whole minutes of my life that I'll never be able to get back," he muttered while massaging his temples.
A bachelor's degree in accounting had trained Colin to be masterful when dealing with numbers, but it didn't prepare him to deal with irate customers like the woman with whom he'd just spoken. Although the call ended minutes ago, he could still hear Mrs. Chambers' shrilling accent ringing in his ears. The department store owner's voice was an annoying mixture of Fran Fines from The Nanny and Karen Walker's from Will and Grace. It was enough to make any man lose his religion.
"Mr. Stevens, are you all right?"
Her perfume marked her presence even before she spoke. Colin looked up to see his new assistant, Nona Wright, standing in his open doorway with an armful of files that he hoped weren't being delivered to him.
"Yes, Nona, I'm fine. Thanks."
Colin rallied to assemble as genuine a smile as he could, then added,
"Is it 5 yet?
Nona laughed. "Not quite,
but it's almost lunchtime if that makes it any better.
Colin shook his head and grunted. I'm forwarding my phone to you for now, he informed Nona. When you leave for lunch, just forward the calls into your voicemail. I'm going to need some quiet time to catch up on these accounts in my inbox.
We'll do.
Nona disappeared around the corner, and to her boss's relief, the files in her hand disappeared with her. The perfume lingered. It had been a rough year for Colin Stevens. What had been one of the happiest moments of his life, the birth of his son, had within hours turned into one of the most traumatic. Shortly after Colin cut the umbilical cord and tearfully held his firstborn in his arms, he'd gotten the news of Essie's death. Mason had left the message on Colin's cell phone, and it was information that Colin kept from his wife for a full 24 hours. He knew that as soon as Angel found out that the woman she loved like a second mother had died in her sleep at 3:57 a.m., on the very same day and at the exact same time that Austin was born, she would be devastated. And she was. Angel went into a deep depression immediately upon hearing the news, and for almost 6 months, Colin was forced to function like a celibate single father. It was the reason why he could relate, in part, to what Elaine must be going through with Mason. But Colin and Angel's situation had been different. Colin hadn't been celibate by choice, and his wife hadn't been denying him by choice either. At least, not spitefully. Although he still had the demands of his 9-to-5 job, Colin had become somewhat the sole caretaker of not only his son, but also his wife, who still hadn't healed from her labor and delivery. Neighborhood friends like Jennifer and Elaine had stepped in to help when they could, but for the most part, Colin, alone, bore the cross that Essie's death had delivered to his household. I feel like I'm enduring the calamity of a modern-day Job. 3 months into what had been the biggest trial of his adult life, Colin shared his heart with TK in a private telephone conversation. I mean, I don't have the repulsive sores that the scriptures note that Job had, but every day that I roll out of bed to come to work, this sleep deprivation makes my body feel like it's been hit by a train. From the other end of the line, TK's reply had been,
Well, there's nothing wrong with feeling like Job as long as you handle the situation with the same faith that he did. Despite those sores and even the mocking of his wife, Job stood strong in his belief that God would work things out. Though he slay me, yet will I trust in him, Colin had said in remembrance of Job's declaration in the biblical passage.
That's what he said, TK agreed. And although your wife is going through a hard time right now, you know she loves you, and she would never tell you to curse God and die, as Job's wife advised him to do. And for sure, you don't have Job's fair-weather friends who stood around accusing him of doing something dastardly to bring the trial on himself. You have people in your corner who are going before the throne of God for you daily, Colin.
I know, and I appreciate that, man.
God expects us to watch over our brothers in the time of need, TK had said. You don't have to thank me or anybody else. I know you wouldn't even think twice about doing it for me.
You're right, Colin had replied. And I know that it's the prayers of the righteous that are keeping me sane right now. Keep praying for me, Coach.
I will, Colin. As a matter of fact, let's take a minute to pray right now.
It was calls and prayers such as TK's that eventually broke through the unseen barrier that for months had prevented Angel from enjoying her son or her husband. Colin still recalled the morning he woke up to the surprise of tender kisses being planted all over his face. At first he thought he was having an erotic dream. He'd had several of them over the months with his wife in the starring role, so this one wouldn't have been the first. After a moment to gather his wits, Colin came to the pleasant awareness that this time it was reality. Angel hadn't initiated any affection toward him since the moment she found out that her beloved Miss Essie was dead. In that time period, their son had grown by leaps and bounds, and at a week shy of 6 months old, he was already holding up his head on his own, balancing his bottle without assistance, and even trying to scoot across the floor of his playpen to reach for toys. Angel's misery had caused her to miss it all, but it seemed that her recovery would make it all well worth it. But Colin's celebration was short-lived. Aside from the early morning surprise rendezvous, Angel had given little time to anything else other than motherhood. As if she were trying to make up for lost time, she'd thrown all of her attention and energy into being the loving mother that she'd failed to be during all those months of misery. While Colin was glad that she was no longer in a deep depression, it almost felt to him as though she'd gone from one extreme to another. To add more tension to his already stressful existence, a week after Angel regained some sense of returning to her normal self, the state of affairs at work began spiraling out of control.
It has been determined that someone, most likely someone on our staff, has been embezzling money from this branch of Wachovia Bank, and as of today, a major investigation is being launched. Everybody, myself included, is a suspect.
Those were the words that the bank's president spoke at an impromptu Monday morning meeting with the managerial team. Being that Colin knew that he was innocent and had nothing to hide, he didn't expect to be affected by the investigation, but he was. A work environment that in the past had been a joy to be a part of turned so uptight that Colin began to despise the very act of walking through the glass doors. And after 4.5 months of rigorous inspections, investigations, and interrogations, Colin had had his fill and was all but ready to walk away from a $75,000 annual income. For him, it just wasn't worth it.
But, baby, if you leave, you'll look like you had something to do with the missing money,
Angel had said to him after one of what had become their rare lovemaking sessions.
It's not like I'd be the first to leave, he'd pointed out.
No, but you'll be the first one to leave who had the inside track to commit the crime. Just be patient, baby. God will work it out.
Angel's encouragement and his patience eventually paid off when the investigation came to a thunderous close 7 days later. Colin stood in his doorway and watched in awe as Ralph Snyder, his counterpart, the man he'd shared many lunches and several laughs with, was read his Miranda rights and escorted from the bank in handcuffs in the presence of his co-workers and the bank's midday customers. The shakeup left a vacancy for a senior audit manager that Wachovia didn't seem to be in any hurry to fill. According to them, a second audit manager wasn't an immediate need, and the current slumping economy wasn't giving them any encouragement. Colin had little choice but to ready himself for the challenge. He had no idea that his one-time work acquaintance had left so many accounts, such as the one belonging to Mrs. Chambers, in such disarray. Taking on Ralph's accounts had almost doubled Colin's workload, leading to many days of working overtime. The bank had pacified him with a modest pay raise, and by hiring him a personal assistant to replace Edna Shields, the 50-something-year-old woman who'd served as assistant to both Colin and Ralph, but chose to leave the company during the chaos. Colin couldn't blame Edna for leaving, but he sure hated to see her go. Nona Wright wasn't the first to apply or interview for the vacated position, but she was by far the most persistent. She followed up so often that Colin basically hired her just to shut her up. The way he saw it, anyone who wanted a job that badly deserved a chance. It turned out to be a good move. Nona was a dedicated and dependable assistant who was just as efficient as Edna had been, but even with the administrative help, Colin's duties were still sometimes overwhelming.
"I'm getting ready to leave for lunch, Mr. Stevens."
Nona overran Colin's thoughts as she knocked on the frame of his office door and stepped inside.
"Are you planning to take a break for lunch?"
"I don't think I'll be able to today, Nona. Did you forward the phone into your voicemail?"
"I did."
Nona paused.
"I can stop somewhere and pick up."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.